Right. So now already we are discussing some of that some relevant cases connected to this chapter, and the other case is that Kushanera cartoon versus state of Bihar. It is also related to this public interest litigation on inhuman conditions of prisoners. So these are the relevant cases connected to this judicial activism. Next, the role of general role of judiciary. What is the general role of judiciary means? To test the validity of law passed by the legislature, as well as to test the executive action of the government, and to interpret the Constitution of India, and to interpret the law passed by the legislature. This is the general role of judiciary, means the duty of the judiciary, because it is the guardian of, it is the protector of fundamental rights. Fundamental rights. And the next one is idea of framers of the Constitution of India. When we go through this Article 142, through this Article 142, the Supreme Court of India has unique power to do the complete justice. Because we can understand the idea of the framers of the Constitution of India, that they want to place the judiciary at the top of all the other organs, because the role of judiciary is to protect the fundamental rights, as well as they want to give wide powers to the Supreme Court of India to lead the judiciary as final arbiter to set right the federal issues and to protect the fundamental rights. This is the idea of the framers of the Constitution of India. Next one is reasons for judicial activism. When the judicial activism will come into the action, what are the circumstances or situations called or invite the judicial activism? Means there are 9 reasons to invite or called for the judicial activism. Those are near collapse. First one is near collapse of responsible government. Means either at a time of confidence motion or non-confidence motion, no confidence motion, if the action, even the action of the speaker is also illegal or causes collapse of responsible government, then it can be challenged before the court of law, means either before the High Court or before the Supreme Court. Or the judiciary itself can use the weapon judicial activism. And the next reason is judiciary to step in aid. As we discussed earlier about this judicial policy making, that is also another reason for judicial activism. And the third one is to participate in social reforms and changes. If the judiciary wants to promote the fundamental rights as well as the other rights of the citizens, they can frame the guidelines and bring it to the notice of the state for its implementation. As I told an example, that is Uniform Civil Code. Uniform Civil Code. So that is also one of the reason for this judicial activism. And the next one is legislature vacuum left to open is another reason for judicial activism. And the next one is constitutional scheme. And the next one is to validity of law passed by the legislature. And the next one is the role of judiciary as protector of fundamental rights. And the last reason for judicial activism is Hinduism of individual players. Means nearly these nine are the reasons for judicial activism in India. And the next one is socio-economic justice and the role of public interest litigation. I explained you about the public interest litigation. Now, what is this socio-economic justice and the role of public interest litigation? Are reasons for emergence of public interest litigation in India. What are the reasons? Already we discussed about the reasons of judicial activism. Now, what are the reasons for emergence of public interest litigation? Though socially and economically disadvantaged position. As I told you, the relevant case, that is Kushinagar cartoon versus state of Bihar. In that case, due to inhuman conditions of prisoners, that public interest litigation was challenged before the Supreme Court of India, and it is the first case, means in that case, in that public interest litigation, the first judgment was passed in 1979, Kushinagar versus state of Bihar. It is related to prisoners' rights. Prisoners' rights. And the next reason is rights of taxpayers. If there is any effect to the rights of the taxpayers, they can move either the High Court or the Supreme Court by way of public interest litigation. And the third one is injury to public interest. And the fourth one is organizational social action. This is also one of the reasons to file the public interest litigation before either the High Court or before the Supreme Court. As well as the next one, court willingness to innovate. This is the main reason for public interest litigation or for the judicial activism. And the next one is judicial activism. And the last one is 42nd Amendment. This 42nd Amendment is also called as the Constitution Act 1976. Why it is reason for the public interest litigation means, in this constitutional amendment, the government focused to reduce the powers of the Supreme Court. Through this amendment, the state introduced the fundamental duties to the citizen. As well as in this amendment, the words socialist as well as secularist and integrity are added to the preamble of the Constitution of India. So it is also one of the reasons for public interest litigation in India, either before the Supreme Court or before the High Court. These are the reasons for public interest litigation. Now, socio-economic justice and the role of public interest litigation. What is the socio-economic justice? It is nothing but prison jurisprudence as well as labor jurisprudence and the prisoner's rights and the consumer's rights as well as the pollution-free environment, and the next one is compensatory jurisprudence, and the next one is the rights related to health and medical treatment, and the next one is rights related to children and women, and the rights related to rule of law, means enforcement of rule of law, as well as the independence of judiciary. All these are socio-economic justice. And you can get all these through the public interest litigation. Next one is Uniform Civil Code. What is this Uniform Civil Code? In Part 4, Article 44 directs the state for the Uniform Civil Code. There must be a Uniform Civil Code, otherwise there is no complete meaning to Article 14. Because according to Article 14, everyone is equal before the law. But if there is some discrimination, then there is no complete meaning for the Article 14. So, Uniform Civil Code is mandatory in the entire territory. But unfortunately, Article 44 is in Part 4. It is not in Part 3. Hence, the inaction cannot be challenged before the court of the law. Even then, because Part 4 means director principles of the state policy, it cannot be challenged before any court of law. But even then, in the case of Sarala Mudgal versus Union of India in 1995, Supreme Court directed the Union of India for the implementation of Uniform Civil Code. So this case, Sarala Mudgal versus Union of India, became very familiar connected to this Uniform Civil Code. Next one is curative petition. What is this curative petition? Before knowing this curative petition, you have to know about the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. The jurisdiction of the Supreme Court classified as appellate jurisdiction, original jurisdiction, as well as advisory jurisdiction, etc., 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 including the revisionary jurisdiction. But here, we know that if we do not satisfy with the judgment passed by the High Court or by the subordinate courts, we can file an appeal before the Supreme Court. That option we have. But if we do not satisfy with the judgment passed by the Supreme Court, what we have to do? To whom we can tell, who will correct if there is any erroneous in the judgment passed by the Supreme Court. Till 2002, there is only one option, that is provision of review. If you do not satisfy with the judgment passed by the Supreme Court, you have only one provision, that you have to file the review petition before the Supreme Court. And that review petition will be placed before the judge who passed the earlier judgment. If it is rectified, it is okay, otherwise it is ultimate. But in 2002, Supreme Court corrected that situation. In the case of Rupa Ashok Hura versus Ashok Hura. And very firstly, Supreme Court introduced this curative petition. Curative petition means if you do not satisfy with the order passed by the Supreme Court, even in the review petition, you have to obtain a certificate from the senior advocate on record of the Supreme Court, quoting that erroneous part or quoting that where is the violation of the law or where is the wrong part of that judgment even after that review petition. Based on the certificate of the senior advocate on record of the Supreme Court, the petition known as curative petition will be placed before the larger bench of the Supreme Court for correction. It is nothing but one type of appeal for the complete justice, and it is known as curative petition.